morning. My name is Aisha and I represent a society called Aisha Society, and we work in slums in Delhi. And so we'll talk about the urban poverty and the transformation model of the Aisha Society. Okay? I'll talk about Aisha, and then my colleague Shiv will speak on his life. He is from the slum community and how his life has changed over the years through the model that Aisha uses. Okay? And then we'll give you enough time to ask us questions. Okay? If you don't have anything to ask us today, you're coming and visiting us tomorrow. Go ahead, we'll have a colleague there who will answer your questions then also. Yes.
So does it mean that's gonna visit you?
Yes, you're going to visit us tomorrow. That's the plan. Okay? So if by chance if you forget to ask us something, don't worry.
Okay.
You have tomorrow to ask us. Okay? And you can also email it to us if you think that you need to ask us later. Okay? Just a small presentation that we'll run through. If you need to ask us something, just raise your hands and we'll stop there and you can ask us the questions too. Okay? Do you know, have you ever visited slums in your life?
Yeah.
In India?
Okay.
Here in India? In Delhi?
Yeah.
Okay. So do they look like this? Or they look different?
They want to be slums.
Look to
be
different. Okay. This is a particular slum in Delhi. Okay. This is how it looks. All made of anything, material, garbage, whatever they can lay hands on. Average size of a slum is 5 by 8 feet, where an average family of 10 people stay. So you can see in this area, you can imagine about 8 huts will have. So where your classroom is, there will be 8 families staying there.
Of 10 people.
Of 10 each. So you can imagine tomorrow you'll see that's a better off slum, but that's what it looks like. And
does that equate to about 64 to 100 people in this room?
Yes.
Okay.
In each room that you see, they have only one room to take care. You have kitchen there, you have your prayer room there, you have a bedroom there, you have eating room there, you're living, everything in one room. Okay? Now they've started building. Maybe a room upstairs or something like that. But this is the particular area. They don't have toilet facilities. No attached toilets. And the government has built toilet complexes where they can use, but it is closed every night. So if you have to go at night due to some reason, you have nowhere to go, just go near a drain and use it. Okay? Population in India, slum population is, as per census 2011, is 65 lakhs. No, it's 65,494,604. So you can imagine how it is.
Can you write that number on the board?
Yeah, you should. So you can say because Indian and American are different. Census 2011. Okay? Delhi population, slum population is 2029,755.
This is the Delhi slum population.
Okay. Aisha works in with 500,000 people. That only comprises of about 5% of the total slum population. And we work in 71 slum communities in Delhi. There are about, as per Delhi Urban Shelter Board, that's the slum board that we have under the Delhi government, there are about 750 slums in Delhi. Okay, any questions? What does Aisha do? ASHA started working, it was founded by Dr. Kiran Martin about 29 years ago. And as a doctor, she was very much interested in giving back to the society. And she entered a slum which was near our head office. And there was a cholera outbreak at that time. So she wanted to give her services as a young doctor to the slum dwellers there. And so health is one of our major component or major activity there. 29 years later, from one slum, we have reached 71 slums, as I told you. One of the activities that we have at our head office, we have a tertiary healthcare unit where we have a polyclinic, and all the diagnostic facilities are present there, lab facility, x-ray facility, everything is there. Along with that, we have a doctor which comes 5 days a week to check on the patients. If a patient a slum dweller has to go to a government hospital, they have to wait for 6 hours. Waiting period is 6 hours. To get a blood test, a 1 month waiting period. To get an ultrasound done, a 3 month of average waiting period. To get an x-ray done, an average of 2 months of waiting period. What will happen if we have to wait? But at ASHA, they wait for 5 minutes. And within the same day, the report is given and the doctors are able to diagnose the problem. We also have a physiotherapy unit, which is free of cost. And the state of art, it was done 2 years ago, is the first of the physiotherapy clinic in Delhi for the slum dwellers. This is the health component, but it's a tertiary health, three-tier health facility that we have. We start right from the slum, the healthcare facility, where we have trained the women from the community itself to be our barefoot doctor or to be volunteers with us. And they are trained in such a way that they can take basic health diagnosis, prognosis, and give you medicines for it, basic healthcare. For example, if there is somebody who has fever, cough, cold, or maybe some infections or allergies, these women are trained to handle those. They're also trained to accompany the patient in case of emergency to the nearest government hospitals. And then the second tier is our centers. We have 12 to 13 centers in each of the community that we work in. And the staff there are also trained in medical. You'll be meeting one of them tomorrow. And by chance, if the community health volunteers are unable to take care of the patient, then the patients are referred to her. She takes care of it. If she is not able to do it, then they are referred to our tertiary healthcare center or our polyclinic, or they are sent to a nearest government hospital. In 29 years, what has happened? There are no maternal deaths in last 5 years. If you compare it with Indian population or Indian, how many maternal deaths? Okay, there are no maternal deaths. There are no infant or child deaths. As you compare, we have, if we compare it with all the slums that we are working in, the infant mortality rate is 16.7. That means only the mortality rate per 1,000 births is 16.7. Only 16.7 children may die under 5 years of age in 1,000 live births. That's the infant mortality rate. If you compare it with India, it's 41. So in ASHA communities, there are 16 children under 5 years of age might die, but in India, it's 41 children die every year in 1,000 live births. 41. Every woman that is pregnant, we take care of her. 98% of women undergo 3 antenatal checkups, as compared to only 37 in India. It's an average that we have taken. 37% women normally go and get a themselves checked up when they are pregnant, as compared to ASHA, when 98% of women get 3 antenatal checkups done. 100% of children are breastfed, as compared to only 40.5% children are breastfed in India. We have only 13% of children who are of low birth weight. When they are born, they are very their weight is not good. But as compared to India, there are 28 children who are born with low birth weight, meaning that they might have some problems or they are in danger of dying. Immunization, 100%, 98% to 100% of children are immunized at ASHA. Of 10 UN specified vaccinations. As compared to 79 to 87 in India, 79 to 87% children. How there's a vast difference of what is happening in India as compared to what is happening in ASHA slums. Because we believe that every life is precious in the ASHA communities. That's why we take care of it. Health for us is very important. The second service that we give is empowerment. If you want to ask about something about health sector? No? Okay. We also have direct tuberculosis centers in many
sectors. Can I ask a question about health? Where does the funding come from? Because the services you provide are amazing. Mm-hmm. I mean, the numbers that you're telling us, that's monumental.
Yes.
I mean, you think about the Delhi and what's happening here overall, what you guys are doing is not typical.
Yes.
Incredible.
It's incredible. Where does that funding come from?
Okay. We don't get any funds from the government of Delhi or India. Okay, we only get some space and we pay the rent to them.
So you still have to rent the facilities?
Yes. Now we have to rent the
facilities.
We pay a huge rent now. We used to get vaccinations free of cost. They have stopped that.
Why? I'm just curious.
Yes. Because they have launched their own program. It's called Indradhanush program. Wherein they say instead of giving vaccines to the NGOs, the government themselves will do vaccinations.
How long ago has that started?
It's about 2 years, 2 to 3 years.
Do they have numbers on the effectiveness of those?
They're coming back to us and telling that it is not very effective. What has happened? Where we are, or where other NGOs are, where the trust and the rapport with the community has developed, they don't trust somebody new, a stranger giving immunization to their children. Because the people who are giving immunization, they come, they visit and just vaccinate the child and disappear. Cleanliness, hygiene, whether they are giving proper vaccination, we don't know. They don't follow it up. At ASHA, we do it.
Is everyone required to be vaccinated?
Yes.
So to live in that area, everyone has to have a vaccine?
They are supposed to. By Delhi standard, all children in Delhi under the 5 years of age needs to be vaccinated.
Are there any major outbreaks of disease in the area where you are?
Like for example, last year we had dengue, chikungunya. We had actually very less incidence of these. We were thinking we'll have a lot because in other areas, in middle class families or higher middle class families, these were quite common. Everybody was falling sick because of chikungunya and dengue. But in slums, it was amazing. It was not. Why? Because of these women. I'll tell you about it.
So, last question.
Yeah.
Think about the differences between the government and what you guys are doing.
Yeah.
I can only imagine that the numbers are drastically different.
Yes.
What type of communication is going on between the government and the NGOs that are going to bridge that gap to allow what you guys are doing to be widespread rather than you be separate from the government?
See, we are willing to cooperate and work along with the government because we don't want to supplement their services, to be very frank. We don't have resources to do that.
Right.
We don't have resources to go and work in all the slums. If you see, we are only working in 5% of the slums in Delhi. We don't have that much resource to work in 95 more slums. We are willing to work with the government if government is willing to work with us.
In your opinion, how close are you to being able to work together?
We are willing.
You're willing, but how close is...
The government is willing? It depends upon them.
Okay.
Right. It depends upon them. For example, in each of the communities, they started their Mohalla clinic, the community clinic. They know an NGO is there. Why not, instead of strengthening that NGO, they are opening their own clinic, wherein it is empty because they have not developed a rapport. We at ASHA believe that first of all, to enter a slum, you need to build a rapport and trust with the community. Nothing will happen, nothing will change until that relationship is built. Like when we enter a slum, our focus for next 2 years is to build the relationship, to remove any misconception that they have. Let them trust us, we should trust them. It's two-way relationship. It's not us giving or them taking, it is also them giving it back to us. And you asked, where do we get the money from?
Don't worry about it.
No, we'll tell you. People like you, common people like you, individual donors, partners all over the world. We have charities in US, in Napa Valley, in New York.
What? Napa Valley?
Yes.
That's where I'm from.
Yes, we'll tell you. I think we'll give you a newsletter, you'll find. We have fundraising every year at Napa Valley. Yes.
Do you
in a vineyard.
A Roma restaurant?
It's called Friends of ASHA. So we have it in US, we have it in Australia, it's based in Melbourne, we have it in Northern Ireland, we have it in Great Britain. So these charities not only sensitize the community about the work of ASHA, about the slum situation, but also fundraise for us. We also partner with local community here, multinational companies. British charity, Can Assist, Canadian Assistance. They do provide us some kind of assistance to us. Yes, we are trying to tap on CSR, hopefully keeping our fingers crossed that more Indian companies will give back to their communities. So this is how we get our money. The next work that we do, the major work, is the empowerment program. Now when Dr. Kiran started working on health, she said she realized that it is not health per se, that is the requirement of slum development or transformation. It is actually building and empowering people living in the community. And that's why the empowerment program was started, wherein she formed the women's group in each of the communities where we work in, as well as children's group. So you'll be meeting some of them tomorrow. Each group comprises of 25 to 30 members. The children are of the age group of 6 to 14 years, and women, any member can come. They meet once a week to discuss about issues related to their own community. They are not only taught rights, their rights as an individual or as a citizen, but also responsibilities of living in a slum community. Meaning thereby, we tell them to take control of their own community. Now these women, when ASHA was not working, never used to get out of their homes. They were always dependent on men folk or the men in their family to do everything for them. even to buy vegetables or groceries, they had to tell the men, please go buy. They used to wear the parda, if you remember, they used to put their sari and cover their face. They did not know who their neighbors were. And these women reformed it and they could come out, and they are so empowered at the moment that they can easily maybe go to MP's house, member of parliament, and get the work done. They can go to police station if there is a need be. They go to slum department, they go to water works or any other thing. And because of that, they act as a pressure group in the community and get the work done. So what they have done is, every house has a legal electricity meter. They all have piped drinking water. They have concrete pathway. They have street lights. And they, if you see, there are no violence or incidents which are antisocial. So this is how they work. They meet once a week. Every member is given 25 houses to look after. So they are called lane volunteers. They go and visit these houses and they see if there are no problem in those houses. If they find there's a problem, they come back and report to us, to the group, and the group decides what to do. Now these women are from different castes, different religions, different ethnicity, different social, maybe some are a little better in economically. So how do they come and sit together? What we started is that we start every once a month, we have a potluck. Each of them prepare something from home and come and have it together. We mix the food. So these biases and what we, the mindsets are changing. Now Muslim women can go easily to a Hindu family and sit in her house and eat or have tea together. And now these women and children's group, they collect 5, 10 rupees or 15 rupees every month to help a needy in their community. So we give a value of generosity to them, compassion and dignity. So these women will go and purchase, maybe there might be an elderly who is alone, no family member, no support system, or there might be a disabled person who cannot maybe earn or something like that. So they'll buy grocery for them, and or maybe warm clothes or blanket, whatever they need, and give it to that person with that money. Or maybe for wedding of their daughters if they are not able to afford. So that's the empowerment program. The next is the financial inclusion.
With that empowerment program, how many different, I guess, committees would you have for, you said 75 slums?
71.
Does it come together in one committee or is it?
No, it's different communities. It depends upon the number of population in that slum. So it might be, for example, we have one slum in Ekta Vihar. The population is 5,000. So we will try to have maybe two groups.
Okay.
But there might be a population in Silampur where the population is 50,000. So we might have 5 to 7 or 8 groups.
Now, is there intermingling or collaboration between each individual group to, like, group to group?
There is exchange visits that happen. So they learn what they are doing. And what we have to do is that we have bi-monthly meetings at our head office. So what is happening in one area is shared with the team of the other area.
Okay. Now, can you go back to the one picture?
Yes.
Those are all women.
These are all women from the slums.
Is this only women that are on this community or this committee?
There are about 35 to 40 women in each group.
And what's the male component to that? Are there males involved in this as well?
These are called women's group.
Okay.
We try to have men's group, but they are too busy.
Okay.
Earning. They say we are here to earn. We will reach that point where we will have men's group. Soon.
Super cool.
So we have, actually, we targeted those people who have some say in the family, who did not have any say before. Children have say and women have say. So they are decision makers. And we have given power to the decision makers. So this is the infrastructure development. I told you that these people, the women, come together and act as a pressure group. And because of that, certain things are taken care of the community. Now if you see first picture, that's a particular slum in Delhi, where you can see there's no water, there's no drainage system. You can see how the conditions are. As compared on the right hand side, you see a particular Asha slum, where there's a concrete pathway. There are electricity, if you see there are wires there, cooler is there. Everything is neat and everything is done in a proper way.
Houses?
Yes. Why? How can they build a house? I'll tell you later. Okay? I think this is from Kusum Prabhu. You'll be visiting this slum tomorrow. So you'll have an idea. Okay? Before, we used to have those tube wells and they used to take water, which is very dangerous sometimes. Now, because of that, we pressurized the government to put. This is water ATMs, where each family is given a car and they can draw about 5 liters of water at a time, and they have a monthly ration, so they should not waste. And this water that they receive is purified water, RO water, so it is good for consumption.
Do you know that? Is that monthly ration based on the size
number
of the
size of the family?
And do you know what that ratio is of like one individual to how many liters a month?
No, I'm not aware of that because they've just started, right?
Yeah, it has just started.
It just started last year.
As I say, because I've seen these out.
Yes.
Coming around
yes.
the city, I've seen those.
Yes. How do they do it? You know, in India, everything can be done. So people might give some money to get more water in that car. But this is the right way where clean water is given to the people. Instead of the tube well where you have, I don't know, more of chlorine and minerals which are harmful to the body.
Want to ask something? Would you rather focus on making each slum better rather than making many slums?
Yes. In 29 years, we could have adopted thousands of slums. Why we just stuck to 71? Because we believe quality rather than quantity. We believe that there should be holistic transformation of the community rather than just we do concrete pathway and go away. We want our slum to become communities, middle class communities. And that's what we actually, in two of the areas where we have actually stopped our work because they are like middle class communities. Yes.
Just quick question about the water ATM. Is it connected to the Delhi water grid or is it connected to a ground source below?
I think it is connected to a ground source below, but they have an RO facility, so it does.
Okay, so it goes yes. through treatment and then it goes.
Yes, they have a machine, a small machine where it gets clear. But in some areas where there's water shortage, you have tankers and then the tanker will deposit the water. You'll be going there tomorrow. That area is on a hilly, rocky area where we cannot have water pipeline. So the tankers will deposit the money. Hopefully they will have ATMs there so that they purifies. Okay? Any other question on infrastructure development? The women also have, you'll see, the toilet, we have about, you can say 50 to 100 people share one toilet. These are toilet complexes made by the Delhi government and they are taken care by the Delhi government only. Now what happened, because so many people are using the toilets, repair, cleanliness is an issue. So our staff or our volunteers in terms of this women's group make sure that proper standards are maintained. or when there is requirement of repair, they do it. It takes a lot of time, but we still try to get it done. And if we find that there are shortage of toilets, we try to tell the government, kindly increase, put more toilet facilities.
How receptive is the government to your recommendations?
Not to ours. We go through the women's group. There are vote banks for them.
Okay.
Yes. So this is how we do it.
Okay.
Women, they are pressure groups. They first write an application with a lot of signatures. Give it to the concerned department. They don't listen to them, 10 women will go. They don't listen to them, 100 women will go. When you have 100 women standing there, sitting on your head, the MLA, that is the elected representative in Delhi government, or he will listen to you. Because after 5 years, he will come to that area to ask you for the votes.
So is that with those, the amount of number, or the amount of women, is that what makes that a pressure group?
Yes. And vocal. They're not quiet women.
They can't be.
Yes, they're not quiet. They know their rights. Mm-hmm. They will ask for their rights. Until and unless the right is given to them. That's what the empowerment program is. To empower a lady to stand for its rights. Any other question regarding infrastructure?
How long have you guys been an organization? You may have mentioned when you were established. When were you established?
We were established 29 years ago in 1988.
Okay.
And because of Dr. Kiran's work, she was given Padma Shri. That's the third highest civil award by the government of India to recognize her work in the slums of India. The third one is, in 2008, we had a visit from then Finance Minister, Mr. Chidambaram. And during his visit, we actually oriented him that people in the slum, people in the slum can not open or access the bank facilities. Can you imagine? They have never gone to the bank, because they did not have any residential proof. So whatever money they used to save, they used to put it somewhere in their huts. Now what will happen? The rain will come, it will get wet, it will destroy. There were a lot of mice there eating your thing away. Or the men in their house would find the money somewhere, drink alcohol, gamble, or just use the money. There was no savings in each of the family. Then very next day, the first financial inclusion program for slum residents started. And with the help of 10 nationalized banks, every individual in Asha slum communities was able to open a bank account with 0% balance and interest rate. Not only open the bank account, but they could avail all other facilities. For example, recurring deposit, fixed deposit, as well as loans. They could take loan for some, like for example, education loan. If the child wants to go for higher education program in colleges, they could take loan for it. That's Mr. Chidambaram giving the loans. A lady could open a new business, for example, beauty parlor, or a tailoring shop, or something. Or a man could have a vehicle to carry goods here and there. There are small businesses they could start. Grocery stores were started, vegetable vendors, anything in that could happen, from 10,000 rupees to lakhs. House improvement loans were given. You asked how come they have good, because they got loans from the banks in a very low interest, and they could build houses. Or so you can see a house being built and house being renovated, so that they can have comfortable living conditions inside their homes. At the moment, we have 98% of loan repayment rate. That means only 2% are defaulters. 98% they pay their interest EMIs on time. 2% are those people because of certain family problems they are not able to. Most of the cases have already repaid, taken second loan, repaid, taken third loan, repaid.
When you say a really low interest rate, what kind of interest rate are you talking?
How much is it? 5%?
Five to six. Usually it is 9%.
For
9%. For us. But for them, it was, when it was launched, it was very minimum interest rate that they had to pay more for the loan.
Is that interest rate still being held to? Are they still offering that
now
interest rate?
Last year, I don't know how, when the Modi government came, the pilot scheme that was launched, it was now launched as national wide scheme. Now every person who is from a backward area can avail of this facility. So maybe we are thinking ours was a project, a pilot project, and since it was very successful, it was replicated all over. It is not easy to ask people to repay. It is not easy. Our team has, we only recommend those people for loan if we think they are able to repay or use money wisely. If you think there's somebody who will just drink alcohol, get 10,000, finish it off in a, no, we don't. Any questions on the financial inclusion part? No? After, yes.
What would a loan be? Like, would it be a half a lakh, would it be a lakh?
10,000 and above.
Okay.
10,000 to 1.5 lakhs.
Okay.
Or if it's an education loan, it depends. For engineering, it might go to 6 lakhs.
And they can ask for a loan for university?
Yes. They can ask for loan for university, and it is not given to the student directly. It will be given to the university directly. And the student will only start repaying the loan after he finds job or 6 months after he completes that course. So in between his study, he doesn't have to worry of repaying. And because of that, our higher education program started in 2008. When we saw that there was this scheme there. Till 2008, we were worried that the children should complete their schooling. When we started, there were children who were not even going to primary school. They were just roaming around here and there and picking up garbage, scraps. But till 2008, we made sure that all children are in school. And after 2008, we made sure that an opportunity is given for them to go for tertiary education or higher education in universities of Delhi or other recognized universities, or maybe courses like nursing, lab technology, physiotherapy, engineering, computer, and like anything, courses regarding IT. And they could take loan from the bank if they are not unable to pay, but Asha used to pay certain amount of money initially for fees and everything. So that's why, and you know, from the slums, the children are not very good in English. So we have a lot of volunteers who used to come and teach English. Now you see this lady, she was the spouse of former High Commissioner of Australia, who then became the Foreign Secretary of Australia. She used to go to a slum and teach English. And that's how we get volunteers from all over the world. They spend three months to 6 months to 1 year. If they are expats based in Delhi, they even do teaching English or something for as long as 2 years or when they are, till when they are here. They're volunteers. We also have computer classes, and they just to tell them, because these people have never opened a computer. They did not have that facility at home to even have a computer. So just a basic course is given to our children so that they are able, when they're going to college, they are able to do their little computer literate. And then to the university.
What do they do?
Basic MS Office, Word, Excel, PowerPoint, Internet.
Is it for only one time?
No. It's a 6 months to 1 year course. And then we have, people going to Delhi University. Till date, we have assisted 1,650 children from our slum communities to Delhi University. 51 of these children are girls, 51%. So you can imagine more girls are going. If you see the cutoff rate of Delhi University entrance is, first list is 99%. You need to score 99% to get into college in first list. Every year, at least 150 to 200 children from the slum communities go to big colleges in Delhi University. They compete with Indian population belonging to higher classes and get into it.
Wait, so 99% of the people who want to go to a university get rejected?
Yes. 99% is the marks that you need to get, score, if you want to get a seat in Delhi University.
And what's the
first
lowest? What's the
lowest goes to about 76%.
Oh, I thought 99 was the lowest.
No, 99 is the highest.
Okay.
100% is the highest, actually. And 76 is the minimum. If they have seats, then. Otherwise, they will... It's normal for everybody. Because the numbers are quite high who apply and there are less seats. We help the children with fees, with books, with bags, with anything that it will help them with clothes. So that they're not discriminated upon because they are from the slum. Along with that, when they are university, we give them internship program in different multinational companies, including British High Commissioner. And that's Sir Dominic there with our three interns last year. Was the present High Commissioner of UK to India. And we have PwC PricewaterhouseCooper, where our two children are there. So last year, about 51 students spent about 6 weeks in different high commissions and multinational companies getting exposure to a professional environment. And some of them are paid for the travel, some of them are not paid. Hopefully this year, keeping our fingers crossed that we will get at least 100 seats, where are 100 places where our children can go for internship. Some of them actually, if they do, and okay, along with this, we do have mentorship program where professional mentors are allotted to each student, and these mentors help them in developing soft skills, confidence, just being with them. So you see, that's the High Commissioner, Deputy High Commissioner for Australia, who just left. And different company. This is the First Secretary, the person who has cup in his hand, is the First Secretary in New Zealand High Commission. And we have different mentors. They spend one-to-one time with each other, at least twice a month, over a cup of tea, where they discuss and talk about various issues that a student might have. Now, this student cannot talk about problems with their families because their families don't have an exposure. These are first timers from their families who have entered a university. So their problems cannot be addressed at home. So they ask somebody who already has gone through it and has an experience in handling these type of problems. Yeah. The next is the job placement. What next? After you complete the graduation, what next? So Asha decided last year to have a job placement officer. And many of our students from the slums are placed in multinational companies. The guy that you see is working for New Zealand High Commission. He did internship there. He started working there. We have one, this girl on top. She did an internship in International Rice Research Institute. She got a job as an HR person there. This gentleman did an internship in Rio Tinto, got a job there, permanent job there. So these are only some few examples of slum children after graduation getting white or blue collar jobs. I'll tell you a story of Mahindra.
We have about 10 minutes.
Yes.
Just give it.
Okay, so we'll give it to him. Mahindra is a student. Shiv will give it to you later. We'll give you shorten your. Okay, I'll just tell you a story of Mahindra. Mahindra is from Ekta Vihar slum community. And he completed his engineering from Galgotia College of Engineering through Asha's financial inclusion program, got a loan and completed it. His family, if you look at it, his father is a mason and mother is a maid. She works as a maid in different houses. Six members in the family, so you can imagine the household. After graduation, he got a job in Cognizant. While he was working there through Asha and through our friends of Asha in Australia, he got a scholarship at University of Melbourne to do his master's in computer science. At the moment, he is doing that. And along with that, his studies, he also did internship at Macquarie there, the head office in. Internship is while you are studying, giving exposure to work.
So you go into like the industry?
Yeah.
And you work alongside with like say an engineer.
Okay.
That's
so now
like apprentice.
Yes.
Yes, apprenticeship. Okay. So I'll give it to Shiv. He will try telling his life to you about it, and then you will come to know if you have any questions, ask Shiv.
Hello everyone. I'm Shiv. I reside in Slumpur, Delhi. My father is shopkeeper, my mother is housewife. There are 8 members in my family. I have been associated with Asha since child. Garibi kya hoti hai? Garibi kaise mehsoos ki jati hai? Ye mujhse behtar shayad aur koi nahi janta.
What is poverty? Nobody else can understand better than me. That's what he's saying.
Mujhe acche se yaad hai wo din jab tez barish ki wajah se mere ghar ki deewaren gir gayi.
I remember the day when because of heavy rainfall, the walls of my house, they fell and there was nothing around us to cover us from the heavy rainfall. And I could not sleep that night as well. Just to fill water for the daily chores in our house, we have to walk for like 2 kilometers and then we have to go and fill water.
हमें सोच करने के लिए भी गंदी नाली और गंदे नाले पार करके जाना पड़ता था।
So the toilet facility, there is hardly any toilet facility, so we have to just go in the open and then defecate. Even the women in the house.
एक दिन मैं अपने दोस्तों के साथ में कंचे खेल रहा था।
One day I was playing marbles, you know. He was playing with marbles when he was young.
और कंचे खेलते-खेलते मैं नाले में जा गिरा।
And while playing with the marbles with his friends, he fell into one of the drains nearby because it wasn't covered. And when I came out from the drain, I saw that I was drenched in mud and dirt and very disgusting. You know. And he was all black at that time. And his hand was bleeding.
But सामने मेरे friends मेरा मजाक उड़ा रहे थे।
But my friends with whom I was playing, they were making fun of me।
और मेरे पे हंस रहे थे।
And they were laughing and they were making fun of me all the time।
मेरे को hurt हो रहा था।
I was feeling really bad because I was hurt, I was drenched in mud, and people were laughing next to me।
और मेरे को समझ नहीं आ रहा था मैं क्या करूँ।
And I just didn't know what to do।
But उसी समय मैं आशा सेंटर की ओर से गुजर रहा था।
And by going back home, I crossed the Asha Center, the Asha Community Center that was there in the community. I saw a lot of children were going inside the community center to study with their books and
everything.
I was 10 years old when I got afraid of what was happening and I just ran away.
But I thought that if they can study, why can't I study?
But then I thought that if these kids from my slum can study, then why can't I take this step and I can go to study and rather than play in the dirt and just waste time.
और मैं उसी समय आशा सेंटर में गया.
And that is when I went to the Asha Center.
और मैंने देखा बहुत सारे बच्चे पढ़ रहे हैं और कुछ बच्चे कंप्यूटर चला रहे हैं.
I saw a lot of children were studying and some were using the computer as well.
और मैंने 10 साल की उम्र में बालमंडल ज्वाइन करा.
And I was 10 years old when I joined the Asha's children's association.
बालमंडल में मैंने पढ़ना सीखा.
As a part of the children's association, I started studying.
मैंने लिखना सीखा.
Reading, writing.
और मैंने अपनी गली में 15 घरों की देखभाल करना सीखा.
And I learned how to look after 5 households of my slum community, the people living around me. I started taking care of.
कोई टीबी का मरीज होता.
There were patients of tuberculosis.
कोई मलेरिया का मरीज होता.
Malaria.
कोई डेंगू का मरीज होता.
Of dengue.
उनको मैं आशा सेंटर में ले जाता और उनका इलाज करवाता.
I used to take those people from the community to the Asha center and get their treatment done and get it started.
अगर मेरी गली में नाली की समस्या, पानी की समस्या, कोई लड़ाई की समस्या होती.
If there was a problem of a drain or of any water problem was there in the community.
तो हम बार मंडल के बच्चे एक आशा लेटर पे अपनी समस्या लिखते और नियर ही MLA, काउंसलर, SHO के पास जाके उस समस्या का समाधान करते हैं.
So the children in the children's association would write a letter, like she discussed about the women writing a letter. So the children would also write a similar letter to the concerned authorities and take it to him and then request him to get the thing sorted in their own community.
और हम सभी बाल मंडल के ग्रुप के बच्चे हफ्ते में शनिवार के दिन चंदा इकट्ठा करते हैं.
Every Saturday we collect you know 5 rupees or a token amount from all the kids, 5 rupees each or something.
और बुजुर्ग लोगों की मदद करते हैं, उनको ब्रेड, अंडा और राशन देते हैं.
And we go and help elderly in the community who are not able to fend for themselves or to arrange general food or things of their convenience. So they go and they give them that money or buy good milk or eggs or things like that they can eat.
इसी सभी मेहनत से मैं अध्यक्ष बना बाल मंडल का.
When I was doing all of this, I became the president of my children's association because there are presidents and secretaries in the children's association.
इसी के साथ मैंने youth club join करा.
I also joined the youth club.
मैं sex awareness के बारे में बताता.
And I talk to my group about sex awareness.
और उसका भी मैं अध्यक्ष बना.
He also became the president of the youth association that they formed in their slum.
और धीरे धीरे परिस्थितियाँ बदलती जा रही थी.
And slowly things started to change. I could see that change happen.
सबसे बड़ी चुनौती थी मेरी 12th class.
The biggest problem for me, the challenge for me was clearing school, like high school, class 12.
क्योंकि मेरे पास इतने पैसे नहीं थे, मैं अपनी टेक्सटबुक खरीद पाऊँ. मेरे पास इतने पैसे नहीं थे कि मैं कॉलेज की फीस भर पाऊँ.
I didn't have any money to buy books for myself, bags for myself, or pay for the fees in the school.
मुझे मेरे सपने टूटते नजर आ रहे थे.
I could see that all my dreams of doing something in life were actually shattering because of the shortage of money.
और एक दिन आशा सेंटर से मेरे को टेक्सटबुक प्रोवाइड हुई.
And then when people in Asha saw my challenges, they gave me textbooks.
और वो बुक्स मेरे हाथ में आई.
And when I had those textbooks in my hand,
और उसका मैंने पहला पन्ना खोला.
And I opened the first page.
मानो मैंने आसमान छू लिया हो.
It felt like I had reached the sky because it was such a good feeling to have a textbook in my hand. That was my own textbook.
क्योंकि उसी बुक्स की वजह से.
Because it was only because of those textbooks.
मेरे 12th में 78% marks आए थे.
I scored a good about 78% marks out of 100 in class 12.
अगर वो बुक्स नहीं होती तो शायद मैं फेल भी हो गया होता.
If I didn't have those books, I could have easily flunked, failed in school, and then not done anything.
और मेरा करियर बर्बाद भी हो गया होता.
Yeah, not done anything in life.
इसी के साथ मैंने एक दिन डॉक्टर किरण मैम ने मेरे कॉलेज की फीस प्रोवाइड कराई.
So Dr. Kiran also supported him with all his dedication, supported him for his college fees.
और मैंने कॉलेज के द्वार ओपन करे.
And she opened the doors for him to college where he could actually go and access what was happening in the college, in her knowledge.
और वो कॉलेज का पहला दिन.
And the first day of college.
जब मैं बस से उतर कर अंदर कॉलेज में जा रहा था.
When I got down from the bus and went to the college for the first time.
मैंने देखा कि बड़े-बड़े घर के बच्चे अपनी बड़ी-बड़ी गाड़ियों से निकल रहे हैं.
I saw that these children of my age were getting down from these huge, big, fancy cars, and I was getting down from the bus.
वो ब्रांडेड कपड़े पहने हुए हैं, मैं लोकल कपड़े पहना हूँ.
They were wearing nice branded clothes of very expensive clothes, but he was wearing some simple, easy clothes.
वो ब्रांडेड शूज पहने हुए हैं, मैं लोकल शूज पहना हूँ.
They were wearing branded shoes and he was wearing simple local shoes.
उनके पास ब्रांडेड फोन है.
They had branded phones of course.
But मेरे पास नहीं था.
But he didn't have a phone only. He did not have a cell phone that he could carry and get in touch with his family.
लेकिन जो मेरे पास था वो उनके पास नहीं था.
But what he had, those children did not.
मेरे पास मेरी आशा की values थी.
He had the values of Asha society that he learned at Asha.
आभार, उदारता, दया, अहिंसा. इसी के साथ मेरी ग्रेजुएशन कंप्लीट हुई.
So he finally completed his graduation after all the challenges.
अब मैंने 2 साल Converges में अपनी नाइट शिफ्ट काम करा.
And he worked at Converges, which is it is a BPO where he worked for 2 years, yeah, a transport company.
और साथ ही में आशा ने अपना समय देता.
And he would also support Asha and the other children in the slums who needed help.
2016 में 35 बच्चों का एडमिशन कराया जिसमें से 18 लड़कियां थी.
In 2016 he got 35 children admitted to college out of which 18 were girls.
और वो 18 लड़कियां एक रूढ़ी परिवार से बिलोंग करती हैं.
Those 18 girls were from very conservative families who would not let their children to go out and study, especially the girls.
उनके पेरेंट्स बिल्कुल नहीं चाहते हैं कि वो रेगुलर कॉलेज जाएं.
The parents never wanted them to go to regular college.
और उनकी सोच थी कि लड़कियां कॉलेज जाएगी तो बिगड़ जाएगी.
So they always thought that the girls, if they would go out and study, they would not be safe and they would not do well in life. They should just sit at home and not do anything.
मेरा और मेरी आशा का एक ही विजन है उन 3000 बच्चों को रेगुलर कॉलेज में दाखिला दिलाना.
सो माय डिजायर माय एस्पिरेशन इज टू जस्ट गेट दोस 3000 गर्ल्स टू कॉलेज हु आर इन द स्लम्स हु आर नॉट एबल टू गो आउट एंड देन गिव देम अ गुड फ्यूचर अ सेफ फ्यूचर.
क्योंकि उनके सपने उनकी उड़ान है.
बिकॉज देयर ड्रीम्स आर देयर वेज देयर विंग्स टू फ्लाई.
थैंक यू सो मच.
We have a presentation
and we have some newsletters for you. If you want more, you should leave it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
We have a couple of questions.
Yeah, you can take it. These are the annual report.
This is you can have one and you can.
Okay, cool. Awesome.
So we'd all like to thank you so much
thank
for coming
so much.
Here. So just